thank you, everybody, for coming and joining us this afternoon. I know that conferences, by the time you get to the last day, and especially after lunch on the last day, clearly these are the best talks that everybody goes to. And no one's at all wanting to take a nap in the corner. So thank you very much for joining us this afternoon. Oh, and then the sun's come out just to spite us as well. So today we're going to technically kind of talk about JavaScript. We're going to talk about why you don't always need JavaScript. And we're going to go through and build some stuff without JavaScript. To start off by introducing myself, hi, my name is Amy. I have come all the way from Australia, Perth in Western Australia, and I'm super excited to be here in Portugal. This is my first time actually here in Portugal. I was meant to come in 2020 and I don't know, something happened and I couldn't make it. So I'm super excited to finally get to come here. I also have a beautiful grey and white border collie dog who gets very, very upset when I leave him. I would like to start off by prefacing that JavaScript is useful. Despite what I sometimes say, I don't hate JavaScript. I mean, mostly don't hate JavaScript. JavaScript is, in fact, useful, but it's often overused and misinterpreted. But the thing is, a lot of the time, HTML and CSS are actually a much lighter option for us to use than JavaScript. And a lot of the time, we can go through and replace a lot of our JavaScript with a HTML and CSS alternative. So today we're going to go through and build a little website. This website will have no JavaScript. That means I'm not using any JavaScript in the build tools. There are no NPM packages. It is just HTML and CSS and a couple of images because fun. So we're going to start off with a few HTML tricks. We're going to look at things like targeting content, how to create an accordion without JavaScript, and having a look at the native browser form validations. So starting with content targeting. Now, we're all familiar with links, right? When I say links, I mean actual links, not divs that look like links and function like links. We have the anchor tag, which we use for links. And most of the time, this is linking to another page or another website, or we may link to a file or a resource like an image or a PDF. But we can also link to an ID of an element, either on the same page or on a different page. We can take advantage of this because we can then use CSS to check whether or not a particular element is being targeted. So if the hash reference of our URL includes an element ID, we can target that with CSS. So we're going to have a look at our beautiful little website, which is about to become even nicer. We're going to go through and write some CSS. So on this web page, I have sections. I want to display all of our sections, none, so I want to hide them. And then I want to check if they are being targeted. I want to make them display again. Now, what this does is this, so here I have a whole bunch of menu links. As I click around, this is now showing and hiding my content. And so effectively, I have managed to build a single page application with no full page reloads and no JavaScript whatsoever. So it's pretty cool. Now, favorite thing in web development, browser support, especially to anyone that saw Phil's fun talk last night. His favorite browser is mentioned for a few of these things. Now, the target pseudo selector is actually pretty well supported. Most of the stuff that I'm going to talk about today is relatively well supported, and I'll talk about any of the issues and disclaimers. This one's been around for a while, and so you can fairly safely use that in your applications. However, full disclosure, we are kind of messing with the URL in this case, and that then is difficult if we're doing anything else funky with the URLs, and it kind of works differently to how the users may expect it. So not a great alternative to use all the time, and it's not spectacular for accessibility. But you can do it, just doesn't always mean that you should. Next, accordions. Who here has built an accordion? Who here has used a JavaScript to build an accordion? Who here has installed an NPM package to build an accordion? Excellent. There's a HTML element for that. It's native. It's built in. I give you the details summary element. This allows us to create a collapsible section, and then the summary tag is where we put our information. This one, it's actually nothing I have to do. It's just there. It works. That's pretty cool. Now, browser support for this one has been around for a while as well. Not supported in Internet Explorer, unfortunately, if you are still using that as your preferred browsers. However, when the browsers don't support it, it just shows all of the content on the page without being collapsed. So that's pretty cool, and that is absolutely one that you can go through and use. And yeah, full disclosure, if they're not supported, everything just displays open. So as long as you're good with that, it's fine. Next, form validations. Who here has built a HTML form before? Who here has set required fields? Who here has tried to fill out a form and at the end it goes, not working, you didn't fill in the required field? This is a nice, easy one to do. You could use JavaScript for it, but there is a HTML attribute which is required, and the browser will already work it out. So the browser will not let the user click the submit button if a required field is empty. It also has native browser errors and is able to be styled if it's incorrect. So that is a really easy one to go through and use. We can also look at the format of our data that comes through. So one of the really useful ones for this is telephone numbers. I was talking about this the other day. Telephone numbers are fun because there are a whole bunch of different things that you need to make sure you have. You need to have the area code in Australia as well as the phone number. And a lot of the time we're working with international telephone numbers, which means we need country prefixes. The pattern attribute is one that we can already start to add to our inputs, and it allows us to define a particular pattern that the content should appear in, which means the form won't submit if it doesn't match the required data format. This is already here, that's ready to go. Another kind of input that we love dealing with, dates. Dates are fun. Dates are really fun. Dates are super fun, especially when dealing with a whole bunch of people in the US building forms, but not actually specifying what the date format is. If I said that today's date was the 7th of the 9th, what month are we in? Yeah. Could be in August. Could be in July. Could be in September. Probably not in August. There is a native date picker that we can go through and use already. This works on all devices. If you're on mobile, it will use the mobile date picker and it allows us to go through and define it. That's a really useful one, super easy to use. Once again, no JavaScript packages involved. Now, the input with a type of telephone and the associated patterns has pretty good browser support as well. That one's also in IE. Pretty much if something's in IE, you're probably safe using it. As to the pattern attribute, that one has also been around for a while. Full disclosure, these are really useful and the browsers will give some error messages to the user. However, these can also be expanded upon by using JavaScript. So you're able to tap into the error APIs and give them a lot more information and provide better user error messages if you're using these. So those are a couple of HTML tricks. Now we're going to delve into some tricks with CSS. We're going to have a look at some nesting using range sliders, testimonial sliders, toggle switches, and every web developer's favorite thing, an image carousel. Starting off, nesting. So, CSS nesting is a thing now, native CSS nesting. One of my favorite reasons to use things like Sass or PostCSS as a preprocessor was I could nest stuff, which makes it really easy to not have to continue to write things out repetitively. However, this has now come to CSS, which means I no longer need to use a build tool to process my CSS. I can just nest it out of the box. This is very, very, very new. So you actually probably are still using a build tool for now, unless it's for personal use only and you can guarantee that everybody's going to have this year's most up-to-date browser. But this is coming, and this is also something that is going to be fairly easy to move towards as the browser support gets a little bit better. Next, range sliders. So we have a HTML input for this already, input of type range. We can set a minimum and a maximum value. These are really common in feedback forms. However, the problem with this is it's hard to convey where exactly what things mean and whether or not they mean the same thing to the user as they do to the people who are interpreting the data. Is anyone familiar with NPS surveys, customer feedback? So for those who aren't familiar, these are surveys that a lot of time we get. So after you've called your telco and they send you, "We would like feedback. How did we do?" And well, you've had to call your telco, so you're probably not going to be really, really happy about it. But hopefully you're not really, really upset about it. So who here would go middle of the range and give them a 5 out of 10, right? Or less, maybe less, maybe you're not happy. So the way NPS surveys work is actually anything below a 7 is a negative. Most users don't know this because there's no way of conveying how that works on a range slider. So what we can do is we can go through And we can provide labels to let users know like what we're actually ranking these things. We can use a data list element, which is used for a couple of different things in forms, and we can provide a few different options. So we can say, well, 0 was not good and 10 was just absolutely fantastic, so happy, best thing I've done in my life, and 5 is, yeah, have no strong feelings about this. So if I go through and have a look here in my contact form, I already have a range slider about how much do you know JavaScript. If I had to give you out of 10, how much do you know JavaScript, who would kind of struggle to work out where they'd sit for that? Yeah, not spectacular. So we're going to go through and write some CSS tricks. So inside of my form, I'm going to go through and use a couple of cool CSS things, and we're going to have a look at how they all work. So here I'm going to write the first one out and then explain how it works. So here, my range slider, I want to go through and select a whole bunch of things. Now, it's really tricky to go through and try and count things in CSS. So trying to count, I want to know how many options I have available on my range slider labels. I can actually do this by using the has selector. So the has selector is about the closest thing we're going to get to a parent selector. And it allows us to look inside of an element without going inside of an element. So in this case, I'm checking, does the form have an input with a type of range? I want to get the data list that is directly next to it. And then I want to check if the data list has an option that is nth child of 1, so the first child. If the form has a range selector that has a data list that has an option that's the first child, I know that that data list has at least one option. Now, I'm not going to type them all out because we've got better things to do than watch me type things. But I can expand this and go through, and because CSS cascades and further down the page will override the previous ones, I can go through and I can keep checking how many children they are. And this way, I'm able to count how many options I have inside my data list, and those options, that number will become available for me to use later. So, now that I've done that, I'm going to go through and I'm going to get input type range, for now I'm going to set width to be 100%, so I want this to take up the full width. I then want to get any data list that is directly after my input of type range, and I'm going to set display grid. Grid template columns, I want 50 pixels, repeat. I'm going to use the number of options I've just got, so I can repeat. I can generate a set of columns that are exactly the number of options that I've just found. I then want to get an option inside of my data list. The grid column should span 3, should span across 3 columns. It should start. Now this one has a CSS variable already on there that I'm going to use in a second. And then I also want to check Is this every second child? Grid row start two. What this should do is this should then go through and lay out all of my labels along my range slider. Now, one final bit that I have to do here, which is I don't actually want the slider to be the full width because I want it to line up nicely with my labels. So I'm going to go through and change that to be calc 100% minus 100% divided by the number of options. And 1000%, definitely not 1000%. And there, it lines up nicely. So now we're able to have a range slider and provide a little bit more context to our users about what we're applying for the different numbers. So I don't have to say, you know, I would rank my JavaScript skills as 7 out of 10. I can just say I use it regularly, or I can follow a tutorial. So we're able to go through and fairly decently provide some labels laid out nicely. Now, what does this look like with browser support? Our range slider has pretty good browser support as well, so we can fairly confidently go through and use that. The data list has relatively decent browser support, apart from Firefox. And the has selector, while pretty cool, is not doing as well, unfortunately. However, there are some memorings that hopefully it will be out on Firefox later on this year, which will be awesome because that is a super powerful one for us to take advantage of. Next, testimonials. Our clients love testimonial sliders. We love to add these. We love to build them. We can go through and build them using radio inputs. So in this case, for my testimonial slider, for each testimonial, I have a radio input for each testimonial. I then have a label for the radio input because all form inputs should have a label associated with them, even ones that we're kind of messing with and not using properly. And then I have a block quote where I can go through and define my testimonial. So this is what my code looks like. I can then go through and take advantage of the trick we used previously, which is to count how many children an element has. Now, this allows me to go through and count how many testimonials I have available in my selector, and I can take advantage of that in the CSS. So, testimonials. Can have a look at my testimonials as well. This one is a little bit messy. And this one has some lovely quotes from the speakers at Copenhagen Developers Festival. So we're going to go through and style that a bit better. So, testimonials. I'm going to start off by using CSS Grid for this. Grid template rows. One of our auto grid template columns. One of our repeat. Again, we're taking advantage. I have counted the number of testimonials. And then at the end, I'm going to set 1FR. And then I'm going to say justify content center because we love to have things centered nicely. Whoops, missing. There we go. See, you guys are already learning something. All right, so we can go through and count how many testimonials we've got, which we've just done previously. Next, I'm going to go through and I'm going to get my input with a type of radio. So I'm going to get my radio input and I'm going to set these to be display none. But I want to check if the radio inputs are checked. I'm then going to get the label that's directly after that and then get the block quote that is directly after that. And what I'm going to do is if the radio input is checked, its associated block quote should be visible because I'm then going to go through and get the block quote. I want to turn off the pointer events, which means people can't select it or do anything with it with the mouse, and set the opacity to be zero. I also want to put that on the grid. So this is going to be 1 to -1, which means it's going to be the start to the end. And then the grid row will be 1 to 2, which means it's going to be the first row. I also want to get the label that appears. And the label, I'm going to use Flexbox. Line items center. I want to make the font transparent. The font size is also going to be super small. So what I'm actually going to do is I'm going to hide this. I'm going to hide the content of the label so that no one can see it. The order is going to be 2, which means all my labels are going to appear after the block quotes. So I want them to appear at the bottom. I can set position. Relative, the grid row 2, cursor, pointer. So that's going to be nice for people to click on. Then want to get the pseudo selector. And this is where I'm going to make my radio button. Going to give it a height and width of 20 pixels. Border radius 50% because we know radio buttons need to be circular. Border 2px solid. I'm going to make these green. Set them to display block. Border radius. I've already done border radius, haven't I? Yep. All right. The before element is also, I'm going to set the content so that one appears. And then the after element, I'm going to copy and paste this so that I don't have to type it all out. The after element, I'm going to set the background to a radial gradient. So what this does is this will make a small circle in the middle with a gap on the outside like we expect it to look like. I then want to go through and I'm going to use another new selector which we have, which is the not selector. And so I'm going to check if I'm going to make sure I'm in the right spot for this. I'm not. Okay, if my testimonials element does not have an input with a type of radio, that is checked. So that means if none of my testimonials have been selected, I'm going to go through and select the first one, block quote, first of type. So the first block quote inside of this. And I'm going to set the opacity and the pointer events to make that visible. I'm also going to make it look like that first one is selected. So I'm going to set content And I think I'm missing. Nope. Let's see how this works. So now, if this has all worked properly, this has not worked properly. Missing a comma on line 57. Ah, there we go. No. All the way at the bottom. Ah, there we go. And no. Here's some I prepared earlier. And I can then go through and, you know, I'm going to zoom out a little bit so we can actually see something on this page. And I now have a testimonials slider or selector or carousel, whatever you want to call it. And I can go through and select the different testimonials that people are able to see with no JavaScript. It's pretty cool, right? So we did that, and we used the nth child to go through and get that to work. Right, browser support. Once again, has browser support not fantastic, unfortunately, but hopefully that will come at some point soon. The not selector has been around a little bit longer, so that's really cool. We can use CSS to check whether or not something does exist or is true. Lastly, CSS Grid has been around for a while as well, so that one's pretty safe to use. Full disclosure, we are kind of messing around with form inputs in this example. This isn't fantastic for accessibility, and using some ARIA labels and roles would definitely give more information for users and assistive technologies. Maybe confusing for people who are clicking radio buttons to change testimonials. And the has selector is not supported in Firefox. But this is a pretty cool one to take advantage of. Next, toggle switches. Toggle switches are great. Toggle switches are fantastic. Designers love toggle switches, and they're so easy for us to build. The thing is, they are actually easy for us to build. Once again, we could take advantage of radio inputs. We can have a radio input that has a value of on and a radio input that has a value of off. And we can create a switch to show whether or not one of them is checked. So, toggle. So here's my toggle. I have off and on. Now my toggle display flex justify content center line items center. And then want to get the label. You know what? I'm gonna copy so I can talk a bit more easily about this. All right, so we're going to use display flex to make our toggle appear, everything appear next to one another. We're then going to set for the label. What we're doing here with the label is we're going to go through and that one will have a little bit of padding around it and should not wrap. So we don't want the words on the switch to wrap at any point. Next, we're going to get our radio input. And once again, we're referring to our radio input, getting the label directly after it. And we're going to create a before element, a before pseudo element that overlays on top of it. We're going to see what that does in a minute. Then We're going to look at them in a second. We want to check if the radio input is checked. We then want to style our switch to appear to have a colored background if it's on. And we want to go through and we want to transition changing what that switch does. If the value is off, we're going to change the switch back. And if the switch is not checked, we want to have a pseudo element appear on top of that. And what that is going to go through and do is require me to save the CSS. What that is going to go through and do is create a functioning switch. Now, if we have a look at what that little pseudo element that I created actually does, I can have a look in the dev tools here. So, what I've done is if it is not checked, if one of my radio inputs is not checked, I've then created a pseudo element that overlays the label and the switch. This means that if somebody clicks on the switch or on the label, it will still register the click. So otherwise, one of the most common issues with when we create toggle switches is clicking on the switch doesn't do anything. So we're able to go through and do it that way, which is pretty cool. So now that we have a switch, I would like my switch to do something. And I want to have a look at the media query where we can check whether or not people have specified a certain color scheme on their device. Who here likes dark mode for everything? I'm not going to judge you if you don't like dark mode. There's a valid choice and there are a lot of different reasons to prefer a certain color scheme. But we can check whether or not somebody prefers to use dark mode and we can change our styles or our CSS variables that we're using depending on their preferences. Now, this is really cool because this means that we can go through and this one I already have here. I've defined a set of color variables for if someone prefers a light color scheme as opposed to if someone prefers a dark color scheme. But I can also then go through and allow them to change it manually. So I have a theme toggle. I have another toggle switch. I can check, does the body element contain the theme toggle where the radio input with a value of light is checked, which means does the theme toggle, is it set to light? If it is, I can change my color variables again. I can then look as well, is the theme toggle have a value of dark checked? I can set it to dark mode. And what that means is I have functioning light and dark mode toggle switch available right here so that people can go through and change it. No JavaScript. Come on, that's pretty cool. Like light and dark mode with no JavaScript. That is pretty amazing to be able to do. Now, once again, browser support, we are taking advantage of the has selector here. So not great in Firefox at the moment. Prefers color scheme has been around for a while. So that one's pretty good to automatically just check whether or not their device is set to dark mode or light mode. Similar to the testimonials we built before, this isn't spectacular for accessibility as we're using form inputs outside of a form. However, radio inputs to toggle between a binary state are a slightly better user experience as long as we're using some ARIA labels and letting assistive technologies know what it is that we're doing with it. The other issue is, as soon as someone refreshes the page, it's going to forget what they chose on the toggle switch. So using JavaScript allows us to trigger more complex functionality and to save the value to persist on different pages and reload. Lastly, we're going to have a look at image carousels. Love building image carousels. I love building image carousels so much that if a client asks me for an image carousel, I tell them, no, I'm not doing it. I list the reasons why we shouldn't do it. And then when they insist that it's absolutely necessary, they must have an image carousel, my quote gets tripled. You know, some people say yes anyway. I don't know why people love carousels that much. So, image carousels, we can take advantage of the trick we just did with testimonial sliders, and we can once again use radio inputs to allow people to go through and select a different image. So, once again, I'm gonna talk through it. So for the image carousel, we're using CSS Grid to define the layout. I will also share a link to all of this code at the end, and I have a blog post available if anyone would like to look through the code a bit more later. We're using CSS Grid. I'm creating a grid which has an image in the middle and a previous and a next button. I'm also going to make sure that anything that flows outside of my container isn't visible. I want my images to take up the full width and height of the space they have available, but I'm also going to set the opacity to be zero. I want them all to be hidden, and I want to set a transition. So when we change properties on them, I want it to animate and ease in and out. I'm setting my image to appear full width of the container. Once again, I'm using my labels to create button type things, the same way we did with radio inputs. And I'm checking whether or not my radio inputs are checked, and I'm styling my radio inputs the same way. Now, if I go through and have a look at my image carousel, I have a functioning image carousel that has animations and allows me to click back and forward between images. So, how am I doing that? I am checking for the radio input that is currently checked. If the radio input is checked, I want that image to appear. If that radio input is checked, I want the next radio input to appear as a button. That is my next button. I can then take advantage of the has selector, and I can check if a radio input has a direct sibling of a label, which has a direct sibling of an image, which has a direct sibling of a radio input that is checked, that's my previous one. And that becomes my previous button. So here I have my previous button. What this means is I'm able to make my labels for my radio inputs appear as buttons for the various different images. I'm also able to target my previous and my next images so they actually sit to either side and they move in and the opacity changes as they are selected, which is pretty cool, huh? Right, browser support. Once again, CSS Grid, not too bad. That's been around for a while, so we can take advantage of using that. Has selector, in case you haven't gotten the message by now, unfortunately not. Apologies if anybody happens to work on Firefox here. I was not meant to attack. Full disclosure as well, carousels still suck for accessibility and for user experience. You should also do a check for whether or not somebody would prefer not to have animations included and don't use them if they have selected. But also, please just don't do this. You can do it, please don't. We looked, you can build it, but yeah, please don't. If you do not believe that this in fact works and you think that I have just made the whole thing up for you, there is a live website here, nojs.amycapers.dev. You can access this yourself. It also includes the link through to the GitHub repo where you can have a look at the code. If you do not believe me, you can try it out yourself. Just not on Firefox, because unfortunately not. So, before my laptop dies, let's sum up. JavaScript is still useful. I do not think it's evil. I do not think we should get rid of absolutely all JavaScript altogether. It is still useful, but it isn't always the answer. So, next time you go to write some JavaScript, I want you to have a think about, can you do this with HTML? Can you do it with CSS? Have a think about whether or not there is an alternative that you could use. But then also have a think about, can you use JavaScript to make it better? Can you use JavaScript to improve the user experience? Can some of your JavaScript be removed? Can it be replaced with some HTML or some CSS? I also want you to have a think about, do we really need to track this? Who has tracking analytics on their stuff? Have a think about, do you actually need to track this? Do you actually need this information before we go through and add all of those tracking scripts? Any questions? Nope. No questions? I will be around for the rest of the event, all 3-4 hours. We've got left. If you have any questions, you can also find a copy of my slides and the website at capers.dev/nojs. And I will be tweeting out the link afterwards on the different platforms that we don't talk about. It will be on the internet on the platforms. Thank you very much for your time this afternoon. It has been amazing to be here with you all. And please, go and write less JavaScript.